know when you're going wrong. It is through scriptures you will know when you're living right. It is through scripture you will know what to do when there is no other person to give you an advice. Look, social workers don't have the answers. Sorry for all of you that have social degrees. But they don't have the answers. I refuse to accept that they do. Because if they do, our world will be 10 times better. Instead, our world is going down every day. So they don't have the answers. I will tell you where the answers are. The answers are right here in your Bible. They're right here. You might not believe. Some of you might say, yeah, right. But that's where the answers are.
Live, Suntan One Network, Kingston, New York.
See, the Bible says I shouldn't put anything in my body that's going to harm this body. That's what the Bible says. Right? But yet our world says, so long you're not hurting somebody else. But if I'm not hurting you, I should go ahead and do whatever I want to do. All right. Give me 2 minutes. Please stay with me. Don't turn me off right now. I need 2 minutes of time. If I get registered in Medicaid, what do you call it? The free health insurance. And I decided to go and waste myself every single day with drugs and go to rehab, who pays for that? The state. No, see, the taxpayer, you and I, you and everybody else is paying for me to get well. Now just imagine this. What if I have a wife and 2 kids? And every money that I make, I waste it in drugs and all that. And they give my family food stamp, and I'm in Section 8. Guess how many people have affected already? I've affected a wife and 2 kids. Right? Directly. And indirectly, I've affected you all. Because through your taxpayers' money, now, even just if for me to take care of my family, you have to help me now take care of my family and help me take care of me. And yet we say, it doesn't matter what you do, brother, bring it to yourself. Just do it. What? You know what the Lord said? The Lord said, he said, love yourself as you love even your own enemy. That means the Lord is telling me to make sure what I do to myself affect everybody in my home and in my community and in my church and in my city and in my state and in my country. And yet this so-called social program will tell you they're smarter than God. It's okay not to have a father in the house. That's what they will tell us. But guess what? Father plays a significant role in every life. Yes. Father plays a significant role in every life. Look, mom takes care, like, I see Sister Betty and her son. You can tell their boys lie on a heap all the time. But you know, once in a while, guess who he wants? Right? Don't you, Damien, want daddy? I know, I see you. Because once in a while, you are crawling. Look at his face. He's laughing at me. He's crawling over to dad. Why? Because he needs, once in a while, a reassurance that everything is what? Okay. Amen. It's not a lot of time. But that once in a while, you can't stop him from going to his father. It's like, all of a sudden, he wants to push the mother away. What happened that very moment? He needs simple reassurance. Just leave him. You're picking him up, looking at him, maybe bite one ear or the other like I do, put him down, he's satisfied. He won't even go to him for a week. Why is that? There is something fathers give that God has put in them to give.
Yeah.
And so fathers, please don't criticize them. It's okay to tell them when they're wrong, but don't stay beating the drum after 2 weeks later. Every time you see that child, you repeat what it did 2 weeks ago. It's old now.
Yeah.
Let's put it under. Forget about it. And we know, trust the child because he's going to make a right decision when that same problem comes up next time. Don't stare things up in the child that is not supposed to be there. And those of you that have daughters, I don't have any. But my God, I love all my goddaughters to death. But those of you that have daughters, once in a while, go out on a date with your daughter for God's sake. Take them out. Let them tell you. Let them vomit all over you. Let them tell you who they like and who they hate. It's okay. I don't like him. I like him. Because if they are free with you like that, before they make a stupid decision, they will come to you also.
Listen and heed.
Provoke not them. So scriptures are given for this reason, to instruct in righteousness, that the man of God may be what? Perfect. Thoroughly furnished into all good works. We are supposed to come to a place of perfection. God is expecting you and I, all of us, to come to that place of perfection. Jesus said, be ye perfect, for I am what? Perfect. And so there is a place. You see, in human eye, I will never be perfect. But Sister Buddha, in God's eye, I'm going to get there. Because I'm obeying him. You know, but Sister Buddha, some people run into you and they don't like you from the very day one. You didn't do anything. You didn't even say anything to them. They just look at your face. I don't like her. Whose problem is that? Yours or theirs? I think it's theirs. You know, somebody, you know what I it's said those days, my college days? I have this line. They are lost. Because it's truly they are lost. I'm a cool guy, I thought I'm one of the coolest guys in the world. So if somebody runs into me in my college day and say, hey, I don't like him, I just say to myself, they are lost. Next. One less person for me to worry about. Don't you know the more people you know and the more people you hang out, it's the more people you worry about? Don't you know that yet?
Young people,
you don't know that? You don't know, because then you're going to try to fashion your life according to some person's life. Ways of they looking at you. You want them to look at you like you look cool, you know? That's why some people start smoking, not because they want to. 10 months into smoking, they're still coughing. You know they don't want to smoke. Why are you still doing it? Because it looks cool. They all do it, so I got to join. Really? You don't live your life according to anybody's edict. Live your life according to the word of God.
Amen.
Why? Because the Bible is very, very clear on this. He said there is going to come a day that he's going to come knocking. There's going to be a judgment. Oh, yeah. We heard that before. It's been a long time. I've heard that since I was 10 and I'm now 600 years old. No judgment yet. It's coming.
Yes, indeed.
Now, let me ask you this. The day you stop breathing, what has happened to you? And there's the judgment for you that day. Because it's once appointed for man to die and then come at what? The judgment. For you that day, your judgment came. This is the other scripture I wanted to share with you. It's also, this one is in Colossians. It's worded a little bit different. And I'm going to show you why it's worded a little bit different. Colossians 3:21. The other one says, provoke not your children to what? This one says, provoke not your children to what? Anger. You know what a wrath is? When you get them the top of your head hit the ceiling. You know, that's wrath. Anger is something that is simmering, hasn't come to the wrath stage yet, but the pot is beginning to heat up to that point of boiling point. And God is saying, either way, it's not good. Because it will affect the young man or young woman the wrong way. Look, every time I've been angry, two things have happened. First, I've been angry at the person that made me to be angry. And then as the longer the anger remains, guess what happened? I begin to be angry at myself. For allowing that person to even get me there. So you see, there's also a reverse effect. Every single time you get somebody angry, they get to a point that they become angry at themselves for allowing you to get them there. But let me say this to you. Every time I get more of my children angry, what I've done is that I have diminished their personal strength. I have robbed them of who they are for a few days. Every time you get anybody to that point that they lose their cool, believe it or not, you've just made them a slave. Because you've taken power over them. And the only way that young person or that child is going to overcome that provocation, see, if you come back and you apologize, it doesn't mean the child will overcome it right away. But if you come back and you apologize, what happens is that the lead of the anger, a lead is placed on the anger. And the reverse osmosis begins to take place. To bring this person back. And sometimes, do you know, for you to come down from anger might take you more days than it took you to get up there. Because first of all, you begin to forgive, and forgiving doesn't mean you forgot what brought it on. And especially dads, if you do not hear the whole story, don't jump in yet. Hear the whole story first before you jump in. Let it be said, let the whole story be clear first. Because your child is not an idiot. He's not a fool. Let them explain themselves. They might explain it backwards, yes, but allow them to finish. I have this habit those days. I used to help my boys out. I thought that's what I was doing. I'll
catch you next time.
Dad, can I finish? I didn't even finish what I was saying.
I don't know.
As you grow older, you begin to learn.